I mentioned that I just want to give you a recap. We started with an analysis based on the mass balance equation for a realistic pressure time trace from an unstable tactical missile rocket motor. From there, we moved to the question of the connection, if any, between low index and stability. I made a statement that low index does not necessarily mean that the rocket will be stable. Okay. And then we went to the question of predicting the index, and therefore I discussed in some detail the steady state burning behavior of propellants. Okay. Now I'd like to get back to the question of stability, its connection to index, especially in cases where the index is lower than 0.3. Okay. Don't worry about this equation. We have a set of equations that describe the steady state behavior of the model. Okay. All that is done is that a simple perturbation analysis where the pressure is taken to be mean pressure plus perturbation, corresponding perturbation in R dot and other variables. Okay. In the steady state equation that we have, you remember, is K dt dx 0 minus is equal to rho p r dot hs plus k dt dx 0 plus. This is the basic equation both for steady as well as unsteady regression. For the steady case, we took this to be the steady case. This was rho p r dot cp Ts minus T0 is equal to rho P R dot Hs plus the gas phase heat flux term, which we found is rho P R dot Cp flame temperature minus surface temperature divided by exponential zeta star minus 1. This is the steady state flux balance, which we have already discussed. When it goes to unsteady, remember that this particular term was obtained as a solution to the steady conduction equation. Okay. And this was obtained using an alpha the right hand side. So, rho p r dot dt dx is in the gas phase, assuming a thin flame. This is what was done. This term came from here, this term came from here. Now, when the conditions are not steady, we cannot use the steady conduction equation. The slope must be obtained from solving the unsteady conduction equation, which in this case is simply okay. So, this flux term, the heat flux that goes into the solid phase, must be calculated as a function of time, because the surface temperature will now fluctuate with time. Why is the surface temperature fluctuating with time? Because the propellant itself is subjected to the fluctuation in pressure. Okay. So, this equation must be solved with the following boundary conditions. T goes to T0 as x goes to minus infinite, but T equals Ts plus Ts dash, Ts is the mean surface temperature plus the fluctuating component at x equals 0. So, therefore, this term will fluctuate with time. This term will have a value that is fixed by the flux balance. What about the gas phase? Okay. Remember that the response time for the solid phase responds with a time scale of a few milliseconds. Okay. On the other hand, gas phase response is much, much faster, probably a few tens of microseconds, and therefore Remember that we are interested in pressure fluctuations with a frequency of about a few hundred hertz and therefore a time scale of a few milliseconds. Okay. So, in a few milliseconds, when the pressure changes from the peak value to the lowest value when it oscillates, the gas phase has sufficient time to adjust to the changes in pressure, and therefore the gas phase can be considered quasi-static. Gas phase is quasi-static. That means we do not need an unsteady version of this term. We can use exactly the same equation that we have been using and assume that it instantaneously adjusts to changes in temperature and pressure. No, so this is the propellant. You have the flame structure here, something like that. So this is x coordinate, and the coordinate is assumed to be attached to the regressing surface. Yes. Yeah. So I mentioned that in the surface heat flux balance equation, we have these three terms. Under unsteady conditions, we need to account for the change in the heat flux that goes into the condensed phase with time. Okay? And therefore, this term is obtained by solving the unsteady conduction equation. One might think that we need to do the same thing for the gas phase also, but it is not required because the pressure changes in the gas phase are happening at a time scale of a few milliseconds. But the gas phase can adjust to changes in pressure within a few microseconds or a few tens of microseconds, and therefore the gas phase can always be assumed to be at a steady condition. Corresponding to the local changes in pressure and temperature, it instantaneously adjusts to the steady profile. Okay. Answer your question. When this perturbation analysis is done, please don't worry about the equation. All I want you to recognize is that this is the response function of a particle of size dA. Okay. We had an equation for the burn rate. This is a corresponding equation for the fluctuation in the burn rate for the same particle size. The fluctuation in burn rate is in general a complex quantity because it can have a certain magnitude and it can have phase difference with pressure. And this is the magnitude and this is the phase. And the response function, we saw the definition for response function already. It is the relative fluctuation in R dot to the fluctuation in pressure, and the response function of the propellant can be related to the response function of individual particles. This is exactly the same, it is analogous to what we did in the steady state. The burn rate of the propellant is related to the burn rate of individual particles in the statistical particle path. The response function of the propellant is related to the response function of individual particles in the statistical particle path. The line average fraction appears again here. Now, response functions can be calculated for a variety of compositions, the same by extending the code. Okay. What I want to emphasize is that though very interesting and very useful, these results are not very relevant for instability for two reasons. The reason one is that the maximum index that we could predict with this approach is only 0.4. But remember that propellant compositions that are used have index as low as 0.2, 0.25. We still do not know how that is achieved. Okay. So, just accounting for lateral diffusion brings down the index from 0.8 to 0.4, not below that. Reason 2, and it is the most important, the response function divided by the index, or the response function scaled by the index, is of the order of 1. Remember that the response function becomes equal to the index at 0 frequency. So, Rp by n will be 1 at 0 frequency. But more importantly, the maximum value of the response function is only about 1.25 times Tn. N is about 0.4. Therefore, the response function is 0.4 times 1.25, which is nowhere close to what is required to trigger linear growth of oscillations, which eventually leads to DC shift. Therefore, the only description I can think of for these propellants are they are very well behaved as far as instability is concerned. Okay. So, the question remains, what causes instability if the regular compositions are well behaved? It looks like the only thing that we have not accounted for so far in the model are the effects of the inhibitors. Okay. One particular inhibitor that I want to mention here is strontium carbonate and the associated binder melt, and of course it could be other inhibitors like oxamide also. What do they do? The theory or the hypothesis is that strontium carbonate, which is an inhibitor added to the binder, inhibits the decomposition of the binder through the endothermic decomposition that strontium carbonate itself goes through. Okay. Remember that the enthalpy or the heat flux required for the decomposition of the binder comes from the gas phase heat flux, and a significant fraction of it comes from the flame between AP decomposition products and the binder, because that flame is what is sitting at the interface between AP and binder. Okay. And this fraction, this component of the flux decreases with increase in pressure, because lateral diffusion decreases with increase in pressure, and therefore even in a normal regular composition, the heat flux that comes for the decomposition of the binder, the fraction comes down with increase in pressure, and this is made worse by addition of inhibitors like strontium carbonate, which can make this problem worse. Okay. And what happens? The binder can melt, but it will not decompose, and therefore there is accumulation of binder at the surface, which can laterally move and cover AP surfaces. Okay. And therefore active AP surfaces are blocked, thereby bringing down the burn rate as well as the index. Okay. So this effect is accounted for through what is called the liquid layer effect, which is simply the functional form is taken as what is shown here. This is a extension of the blocking effect in hybrid rockets to the extreme case where the surface is blocked by the melt itself. Okay. And only by this way index as low as 0.25 could be explained. Okay. Here I have shown prediction for one such composition, and the index of this propellant is about 0.25, and index as low as this can be explained only by additionally accounting for the shielding of the heat flux reaching the surface because of the binder melt that is covering the surface. Okay. The physical mechanism is shielding of active AP surface by binder melt. While this occurs in all propellants, for example, small particles which are fuel rich can have binder melt even in regular compositions due to the heterogeneous fuel distribution, but it is made worse by strontium carbonate. What does it mean to the frequency response? Okay. So, because of the addition of the liquid layer, an additional term appears in the liquid layer, an additional term appears in the response function equation because of the liquid layer effect, and this fluctuations in binder melt caused by acoustic pressure fluctuation is hypothesized to lead to high response values. Only by accounting for this effect, response function as high as 3 can be explained. How do we know that this is the case? Well, can't know for sure, but removing strontium carbonate from the composition significantly improves the stability margins of the rocket, not just statistical stability but also dynamic stability. That means that you can pulse the rocket, create a pressure disturbance, and see that it decays. The pulse decays with time instead of growing. Okay. So I guess this cannot be far from the truth. So to summarize, the current framework is a significant improvement over the earlier ones, usually BDP based models, Bechstedt, Darin, Price models, which did not evolve to a stage where practitioners can use it for designing propellants. More importantly, this framework can yield results much faster than CFD calculations, especially for response function calculation, and can accommodate a variety of ingredients, which is difficult with CFD calculations. Let me go through. So, we have found more willingness among practitioners and developmental agencies, space as well as defense, to accept the theoretical basis of the model compared to academics, mostly experimentalists. Right now we are working with VSSE and HEMRL to integrate the software into their propellant development process. Progress has been slow but steady, but we hope to soon see wider acceptance of the model for development as well as research. Why it's important? We think it is important because we have an opportunity to lead instead of follow, aided by insights from a theory. I'll just stop with this. Thank you.